the colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you.
Hello, and welcome to Anchor TV. Shot from the hub in beautiful downtown Cartersville, Georgia, the only show whose host is Mr. Bobby Lawrence. Hello, Bobby Lawrence.
What's going on, Gordon?
How are you?
What in the world have you got on today?
New format, new set of threads, man. I got this tie, I got the kerchief, the shoes and the socks match the stuff. I figured I'd go classy, you know? Look at this. I leave here, I got the sunglasses to go with it. That's terrific.
Is that your funeral going clothes or your church going clothes?
Both. I'm not rich.
Oh.
I wear them to funerals, to weddings, to this place, and to church.
Oh, I got you.
When I go to church. I'm the only one that wears this stuff when he goes to church because it's kind of a nice laid-back church, so sometimes I kind of stand out when new people show up, so I got to figure out.
Well, I thought you was just wearing that to try to impress our next guest.
I am, actually. This is exactly what I'm doing. Who is our next guest, by the way?
Pastor Grant Cole.
Pastor, it's good to see you.
Good to see you.
Yeah. Man, this is wonderful. Man, I've been trying to get you for the longest.
Yeah, it's been a little while.
We had Greg Moss on last week.
Oh my goodness!
So this just is all worked out perfect. He spoke about coming to the laundromat and meeting you.
Absolutely.
Oh, and you're the author of what's the name of the book?
Into the Darkness and Out into the Light. Yep, 1 Peter 2:9. He has called us out of the darkness and into the light. And the reason I call it Into the Darkness is that when God put it on my heart to write that book, I wanted to just, you know, share the testimony I usually share. Give a brief description of what life was like before Christ and then all about what it's been like since. But the Lord really impressed me that I needed to share how I ended up in the situation I was in. So it's Into the Darkness and then coming out into the light.
Well, tell us a little bit about that darkness, if you don't mind.
Well, you know, it's... you know, it kind of tells you about how I ended up in that situation. It started out innocent enough, you know, in my family.
Yeah.
My father was a big drinker. He would give me sips of beer when I was 5 years old. You know, at 7 years old, I'm popping tops at the parties at the lakes and stuff like that. You know, I got into a fight with a couple of kids, and he seemed to really put his stamp of approval upon that. And so it was just these mixed signals, you know, from my parents. They would have never wanted the things to happen that did. And then when we moved, we were growing up, I grew up in a little town, Toccoa, Georgia, up in North Georgia. And when we moved to the Atlanta area, of course, the whole drug scene was going on. I was just in the sixth grade, and I just fell in with that crowd. And, you know, and it just one thing led to another, and I just got deeper and deeper into the darkness.
Now, if I remember correctly when I heard you speak, you went to prison for a while?
Well, three times. When I finally came to the Lord, it was my third time to prison. Of course, I'd been through five different drug programs. I'd read all kinds of books on self-help and got involved in a cult called Scientology, a lot of people have heard of, looking for different answers, you know, but the answers I wanted to find. You know, that's what I was trying to make it work. Yeah. I was convinced I could make it work. And so after 22 years of drug addiction, it was in 1990, they had just started giving out life sentences for drug charges in Georgia. Cobb County was the first county to do that. And I was arrested. There was about 13 of us, I believe, that were targeted for life sentences. And that got my attention.
Wow.
And, you know, it's so amazing how when things happen, you think they're so bad at the time. But I've thought about it a lot. If I was facing 15 years, I wouldn't have repented. I wouldn't have. I mean, I'd just done 2 12s and a one, you know, years before that.
A 2 12 and a one.
Yeah, the second time. First time in prison, I had 5 7s and a one. Second time in prison, I had 2 12s and a one. This time, if they'd have given me 15 years, I wouldn't have repented. Now, 20 years, that'll get your attention, okay? Especially your third time going because, you know, now I was going to get an EH number. And that H stands for habitual. It means they're not trying to rehabilitate you anymore. It means keep this guy off the street as long as possible. You know, it's called an habitual. But that life sentence, brother, that got my attention.
Oh, yeah.
That got my attention. I fell to my knees, and I cried out to God. And I said, you know, God, because I've always known God was there. I mean, he messed with me all the time. He did. He would mess with me continuously. And but I didn't know you could have a personal relationship with him. You know, I looked at him like kind of like the Star Wars, you know, that force that's out there. Yeah. And but I dropped and I said, you know, God, I said, I've been through, you know, this will be my third stretch in prison. I've been through 5 drug programs. I just started pouring out all things I've done to try. And I said, please, God, save me. And I didn't know what save being meant in the way that we understand it as Christians. I meant, I'm drowning. You know, and I'm going to be honest with you. My attitude was either reach down here and do something or kill me, and I don't really care which one. And as soon as I cried out, please, God, save me, this blanket of peace just came over me. I mean, I knew that it was God because I was in a state of panic. I mean, I thought my life was over. And as soon as that peace came on me, I remember I looked across my bunk there in my prison cell, and there was a bunch of papers stacked up. And it was almost like something was radiating on and off like a neon light. And I reached over, and I grabbed out this book, and it didn't look anything like a Bible. It had an American heart on the front of it. It said, "Good news, America. God loves you. The New Testament." And I remember looking at that, and I thought, the New Testament, doesn't that have something to do with the Bible? And so I opened it up, and I began to read. And the second time I was in prison, I tried to read the Bible. I was in a cell with nothing but a Bible. I couldn't understand anything it said. And I remember, though, I got to a part where Jesus said, "Woe unto all you lawyers and hypocrites, and who lay men's souls with burdens you wouldn't touch with one of your fingers." And I remember that time I threw the Bible down. I said, "Finally, me and God agree on something. I hate my lawyer, too." But anyway, this time I opened it up, man, I could read it. I mean, I understood it. I mean, it was a New Testament, so I'm reading the genealogy, and I'm like, look, fascinated, because I'd heard of David, and I'm going, is that the King David that killed Goliath? I mean, somewhere I'd heard about that in my history. And then, you know, talking about Solomon, I'm thinking, man, was that the rich guy? You know, was that David's son? And all of a sudden, I began to think, you know, this must be one of those easy reading Bibles. You know, I'd heard about those in prison. Need to get an easy reading Bible. So I looked at the front, and it said King James Version. I said, yeah, it must be an easy reading Bible. I went to find, who is King James to? I need to figure out who he is. And so I just poured myself into the Bible, and I remember I'm reading it all night long. And they, of course, they turned the lights off, and in my prison cell, in the Cobb County Jail, there's these long, slim lights, and the searchlights kind of put a little beam coming into your cell. So I'm in there, man. I mean, I've read through the Gospels, man, and I've got to the Gospel of John. And as I'm reading through, you know, I'm beginning to pick up on what's going on. Here you have Jesus Christ, the Son of God. I had no idea why he died on the cross at this time. It didn't make any sense to me. But he was walking the earth, and he was only speaking good things, okay? But you had this other group of people over here, these Pharisees and Sadducees, who I didn't really understand them either. But they were doing their own thing, and they didn't like what Jesus was doing. And so, you know, as far as they were concerned, you could just crucify them. And as I began to read where they're yelling, "Crucify him, crucify him," it was like I felt that spirit that must have been there. I've been in a prison riot before. It's kind of like what you see going on in the news now with the riots and the burning. This is a spiritual thing. It's like a wind that blows, that catches you up. And that's what a prison riot is like. And so it's like I just felt what must have been the atmosphere. And I remember I took that Bible and I threw it down on my bunk and I said, "Lord," I said, "I can't believe those people back then were that wicked." And all of a sudden it hit me. It was like God just hit me. Listen, I'd heard about Jesus Christ. I'd heard about the stuff he did. I can't remember where. But I'd heard about it, but you know what? I didn't care. As a matter of fact, as far as I was concerned, you could crucify him. And all of a sudden, it hit me that I was like the most wicked people I'd ever read about. It was the first time I ever realized that what I was doing was really wicked.
Oh, yeah.
And let me tell you something. You know, isn't it amazing how you can spend all those years and go through all that stuff, but God will give you one revelation, one light of understanding that can completely change your life. I mean, at that moment, I decided right then I was never doing drugs again. And I mean, and I kept thinking to myself, somebody needs to come in here and whip the tar out of me because I deserve it. I mean, I'm talking about, you could have, I was telling God, I said, they can put me in the electric chair and I'll never get high again. I mean, it turned me upside down that one moment.
Yeah.
And so I kept reading, right? And so I get through the Gospels and I get through the book of Acts and I hit the book of Romans. And I'm talking about now it's about daylight. And I realize, man, I'm not reading stories anymore, right? I'm into some deep stuff. And I get to where God's talking about the difference between law and grace. Now, I didn't have a clue what grace was. Now, I ended up in a prison cell the first time I was in prison, and Amazing Grace was written on the wall, and I had nothing else to do, so I memorized the song. I mean, everybody in prison knows Amazing Grace. Nobody knows what it means, but we all know what the song is, right? And so I'm reading about the difference between law and grace. I don't know what grace means, but I can tell it's better than law. Amen?
Yeah.
And I'm under it, whatever it is. And about that time, the cell door opens. And they had church call. Well, I didn't know they had church call in jail. And it's like they're trying to hide it. Because it was before daylight. Everybody's still asleep. Nobody's up. But they give church call. So I get out and I go to that church service. And they chain us all together, you know. We walk into this room, and there's this guy there. He's going to speak to us. And I knew he was a cop. You know, like, I mean, I could tell a cop, by the way, right? And I thought, man, what's the police doing preaching? And I thought, you know, I'd always, my idea of church, I'd seen movies where you went into a confessional. I thought, I know what it is. They're going to try to get us to talk. I'm sitting there thinking, you know, there's something funny going on here. And there was this lady, she's very well known around here, named Libby Weatherby. She was a country singer who learned, who got saved and began to preach the gospel, to sing the gospel. And man, she was singing like an angel. I felt the presence of God. And the first thing this guy did is he got up and told us he was an ex-police officer. And he got saved. And now he was the chaplain of the jail. And here's what blew my mind. It's like when I was reading about the difference between law and grace, not understanding it, somehow, Bobby, God let me know that my whole life was changing right there that night. Without understanding how it was happening. It was like God had given me a peace that I didn't have to worry about the police. I didn't have to worry about the court system. I didn't have to worry about my family. I just had two young children. I was already caught carrying the guilt of a younger child the first time I went to prison that I wasn't there for him. And he just put it across to me. I was starting everything new there. Well, when that guy got up, here's what he said. He explained to me that the reason Jesus Christ died on that cross was so that I could have that forgiveness I already knew I had. Okay, so it wasn't like he was teaching me something to look for.
Yeah.
He was explaining to me what had already happened to me by myself in a prison cell with me, the Bible, and the Holy Ghost. And then he said these words. He says, if you go through life and you don't care what Jesus Christ has done for you, you might as well be the people who nailed him to the cross. And I remember I just shouted out a cuss word. Because, I mean, I was amazed. I said, oh, and then when I did, it sounded dirty. And I thought, well, that sounds dirty because I'm in church, right? But let me tell you, I said the sinner's prayer, you know, kind of put the nail in the experience there. We walked back into the day room, and of course now everything's going on, right? People are up, superlatives are flying everywhere. And every time I heard a cuss word, it sounded dirty. And then, of course, I cuss so bad, you know, they're coming out of my mouth, and I'm cringing. And I actually had a man come up to me and go, man, what is wrong with you? I said, I don't know. All I know is I dropped to my knee in the cell last night, cried out to God, got a peace, read the Bible all night, went to this church service, some police preached. I done prayed and asked God to come to my life. Now, cuss words sound dirty.
That's good.
And I'm going to tell you something. From that moment on, God started changing my life, and he gave me a hunger and a fascination with his word. And I imagine I probably read it more than most people because I had more time because I was in prison during the first time studying the word. And now as a pastor, you know, I have, you know, 15 to 20 hours a week to study the word. And I'm more fascinated by it now than I ever have been. And there's just no end to the depth of it and the life-changing that it does in our lives.
I love you. Well, let me ask you. You said you felt like he was after you from the long
before. Oh, yeah.
Why do you think that was? Why do you think that was? Was there just that call, or was there somebody praying for you?
You know, if there was someone praying for me, I don't know who they were, because My family was not into crime or anything, but they definitely did not know God, okay? My father was one of those guys. He was a businessman, never was really there. Like I said, drank a lot, he knew that there was a God. He knew that this country was great because of biblical principles, but no church background. But God has a call, upon people's lives. But I'll tell you a little story. When I was born, my mother wanted to have me, christened in a Methodist church in the town in Tocoa, Georgia. And so there was a family joke, that when they christened me, that the pastor held me up over his head and started walking around the sanctuary talking about, here is a pastor. I'm carrying a pastor. And my dad didn't know if that was just part of the service or what. And when he came out, everybody was joking about it, like of all the people's kids to do that with, that pastor doesn't know what he's talking about. Of all the pastor's kids, of all the people's kids to do that with, why would he choose you? Because my father was known for throwing big parties. James Brown would come and sing. He was, back then he wasn't famous yet. He would come and do parties at the lake, and they'd throw moonshine. He was just a big party guy. And James Brown, he was a janitor in a Tocoa high school and met my mother.
Really?
Yes. And my father had a real affinity for African American people. He was a vice president of Wright's Manufacturing Company. And whenever he would meet different people that needed help, if he couldn't get them a job in the plant, he'd bring them to our house and just let them work in the yard and stuff like that until he got them jobs. So he just knew a lot of them. And so they would have parties. James Brown took me up on this pavilion, and we poured baby powder all over the floor, and he taught me to do the twist. No joke.
Really?
Yeah. And they were throwing moonshine on the lake and throwing matches in it, and that's how the bonfire would burn. Apple brandy and all this. So anyway, so it was a big joke that he was the one whose son did that. And so, of course, when I really got into my life of crime and so forth, and once you go to prison, everything's out there. And it was always a joke in the family that, you're the one the pastor said would be a pastor.
So he was prophesying your future.
He did prophesy. That's the only one I know of. That's the only one I know of.
Man, that's wow. And now, now you were serving a 20-year sentence then?
Okay. Well, the first
time. Or life.
Okay. Well, I was facing a life sentence. And like I said, they had targeted 13 of us for a life sentence. My lawyer came to me and said that the only plea bargain they would give me is that I would plead guilty for 30 years, which is the same thing. Other than that, they were taking me to trial. I thought I was real smart. I had all these plans. Like, I would do stuff like I had code cards, and we could communicate on beepers without speaking through numbers. And of course, the police raided someone's house and got a code card and can decipher these messages. And so they were proving that I was a career criminal. That I wasn't just someone who got busted again, but it was my way of life. And so they just had all this on me. So, I wasn't going to plead guilty for 30 years. That's the same thing as life sentence. The only difference is one day you'll get off parole. You're not going to do any more time on life sentence if you're that. And so that's when I came back into my cell, was after talking to my lawyer, who was, I won't say his name, but he's the best known drug lawyer in Atlanta. And, he's like the Bobby Lee Cook for drug addicts. If you murder somebody, you hire Bobby Lee Cook.
Yeah, I got you.
If you're a drug addict, and if anybody listens to us, they know who he is. But anyway, I gave him all that money, and he's telling me that. See, lawyers usually lie to you. They come in and say, oh, no worry, man. I can take care of this. No, he's telling me, man, this is it. And so I just went ahead, and I did have some old probation left from the previous sentence. I said, look, just waive it. Send me into prison. Because I found out the difference. The difference between having an expensive lawyer and a court-appointed attorney? Okay. With a court-appointed attorney, you just go to court and get your time. When you hire a really good one to pay him a lot of money, you go to court, 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 and then you get your time. So I knew I was going to get to go to court for a few years. I went ahead and just waived all my rights and went on into prison, But God had other plans. Do you want me to tell you about it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Man, yeah. You're interested?
So,
yes.
So while I'm in jail, this happens the day I come back from that first church service, right? I come back in there, and I'm already amazed because something's going on, right? I don't know what it is. And all of a sudden, they yell, the Gideons are here. Well, I would go into motel rooms, and I would pull out that Gideon's Bible, and I would lean it against the curtains to make sure nobody could peek in there. So I knew what a Gideon was on the Bible, but I didn't know anything about him. And so in my mind, I'm thinking there's going to be these long, white-haired guys like from, you know, some kind of mystical movie. They're going to be glowing out there, you know, like, what are the Gideons doing in jail?
Floating.
Yeah. And so it was amazing. All these guys line up, and they're getting Bible studies. And so I come to the door, and I look through the little hole, and there's a guy out there, and he does have a beard. He doesn't have long hair, but he is glowing. And his name was Johnny Ferguson. He's going on to be the Lord now. And so I said, you know, you're bringing Bible studies in here. And I said, how much are they? Because, you know, I came out of Scientology. Every time you buy a book, man, it's hundreds of dollars. You want to take class $5,000. Hey, where'd he go?
The rapture. He was raptured. You know, Kirk Cameron was right. I didn't put much stock in Kirk Cameron, but I do now.
No, serious, man. That was a great interview, wasn't it?
That was a good interview. We got to have him back.
Man, I'm telling you, he can go and go. He's got so many great stories. I'd love to have him back.
You want me to read this?
Yeah, you're good.
This is from his book. This is his kind of testimony here. He was a top student from a loving upper-middle-class family. So how did he end up serving time in 6 different prisons 3 separate times? This powerful memoir chronicles one man's remarkable journey as he struggles through various drug programs, studies psychology, and even looks to Scientology in a desperate search for answers. Finally, after finding himself threatened with a life sentence and void of any hope, God answers his prayer for deliverance. From the jailhouse to the White House, this journey is more than just a story. If you have a loved one who is addicted and or struggling to overcome addiction yourself, this inspiring book offers help and hope. And look, here's a picture. That's what he looks like 22 years ago.
Hey, I'm Randy Richardson. I'm with Change 2 Ministries. We're doing an outside event today for the community. We went out and handed out about 750 door hangers, and we got a good crowd here. We're going to give away some book bags later on for the kids. We're feeding everybody chicken tenders and fries. And, of course, we're sharing the gospel message. So we do these events periodically. Of course, the outside event is one of our favorite things because we always have a lot of fun, especially with the kids. We got inflatables here for the kids, and that always draws a big crowd because if you can get the kids here, the parents are going to come too.
Hey, everybody, how's it going? I'm out here with Change to Change Ministries, and I just had an incredible opportunity to preach the truth of Jesus Christ to the people who decided to come out and have fun with us. Man, I had a great time. Any opportunity that you have to share the gospel with people, you have to take it. And in this event, man, it's been a lot of fun. People are here, people are eating food, but my biggest hope and my biggest prayer is that someone who heard the gospel message tonight would surrender their lives to Jesus, because we can have chicken fingers, that's food, but there is a food that leads to eternal life, and it's the truth of Jesus Christ.
Welcome back. Man, well, that was a great weekend, wasn't it?
We had a wonderful weekend.
A lot of fun.
A lot of fun. It reminded me of the community events that we had thrown before. We did a lot of stuff under huge tents, under the Church Street Bridge in beautiful downtown Cartersville, Georgia. And we had a lot of people come to those things. Tell them how many people got saved out of how many events.
I think we had over 1,028 events.
1,000 people get saved in 28 events. I'm going to tell you how these events worked. Okay. All right? Here's how they went down. You didn't believe in hot dogs and hamburgers. You were like, that's for squares, man. I'm going to have barbecue chicken. I'm going to have fried fish. I'm going to have hush puppies. I'm not going to go to the grocery store and buy some crinkly, rinky-dink fries like some chump. I'm going to get real potatoes. I'm going to peel the potatoes by hand, and then I'm going to cut them and make fresh, real fries. So we had real French fries, homemade French fries. Then we had a dessert, which was usually a couple of cookies, maybe a piece of cake or something. And then we had Kool-Aid, iced tea, and water. I was always partial to drinking the Kool-Aid.
Oh, boy, I had a great time this week.
It was a lot of fun.
A lot of fun, good show. And we sure appreciate y'all being here. And hope to see you next week.
Tell them about getting in touch with us for questions.
Yes, if you got any questions you'd like for us to answer, Texas on the number on the screen there.
Hard questions. So you can get closer to Christ. Say goodbye, Gordon.
Say goodbye, Gordon.
Bye, Gordon.
I see trees of green.
Percentage-wise, they said the battle at Altoona Pass was the most bloodiest battle in all the Civil War. But something happened then. Instead of talking and communicating, they started reacting. And the next thing you know, they found themselves in the most bloodiest battle in all of history. In fact, even up to today, more people's died in the Civil War than all other wars combined. The city of Corinth was a port city. It was a diverse city. Worldliness started creeping into the church because of division. And Paul wrote to him in 1 Corinthians, and he said, "Brothers, there's division among you." He said, "I'd have you all saying the same thing." Today we start hearing different people saying different things. What do we believe? It's part of what's going on in our culture today. Worldliness has crept into the church. Sort of like the Civil War that happened 100 and some odd years ago is even starting to happen in the church. Paul would say, "Brother, I'd have you all saying the same thing." He says in the 4th chapter, the 14th verse, he said, "I write this to not shame you, but to warn you." He wanted to counsel them. He came with them with confidence and care. And then he said, "You have many fathers." And he said, "I'd have you imitate me or follow me as he followed Christ." He's telling them, he's demonstrating how we should live before one another in the world. Not caught into worldliness and the lust of this world. Then he goes on to write this. He says that some of you are puffed up. So he's hitting the issue right there. He's saying, y'all are full of pride and arrogance. So then Paul said, "Should I come with you with a rod? Or should I come with you with love and peace and meekness?" Lord forbid. There's much division in the body of Christ today with our worthless arguments. They were battling the same thing back then. In the day of Pentecost, 120 people were gathered in the upper room. Could you imagine 120 people in one mind and one accord? That meant they were in perfect unity. It's hard to get 10 people in a room today and have perfect unity. It's hard to have it in our own house with our wives or our husbands or even our children. And we wonder what's going on. Is there division among us, brother? Lord forbid. We have to go back to the Word of God and find out what our common denominator. What is that? Love God first. Love God. That ought to be our first thing. Or, just like the church in Corinth suffered, or go back 100 and some odd years to the Civil War, could we be heading in the wrong direction?
To myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by.